देवाय नारायणं नमस्कृत्या नरं चैव नरोत्तमं देवीं सरस्वतीं व्यासं ततो जयमुदीरयेत्। नष्टप्रायेषु भद्रेषु नित्यं भागवत सेवया भगवतेरुत्तम श्लोके भक्तिर्भवति नैष्टिकी। कृष्णाय वासुदेवाय देवकी नंदनाय च नंदगोपकुमाराय गोविंदाय नमो नमः। थैंक यू वेरी मच। सो नाउ लेट अस बिगिन द सेकेंड चैप्टर ऑफ अवर भगवद गीता। सो यस्टरडे ऑल ऑफ यू सॉ that how there was a scene of a battlefield. Bhagavad Gita started where there was a fratricidal war between a family only. See, in Satyuga, demons and demigods, they used to live in two different planets. In Treta Yuga, demons and demigods or saintly people, they started living in same planet like Ravan and Lord Ram. Both of them were staying on the same planet. And then in Dwapar Yuga, demons and demigods or good people and bad people, they started staying in same family. We see here Kaurava family, Kaurava and Pandavas. Both are in same family only. And astonishingly in Kali Yuga, demons and demigods means good people and bad people, they stay in one people only, one person only. So we have both divine side also and demoniac side also. So this is the beauty of Kali Yuga. So Bhagavad Gita started with a war between family people, Kauravas and Pandavas. Pandavas started to, they tried a lot to stop this war, but they could not. They sent Krishna as Shanti Dut also, but nothing happened. So then Krishna was from Pandava side, and then all of them they assembled on Kurukshetra. All of them they assembled on Kurukshetra, and Arjuna is seeing the army and getting bewildered. Oh, how can I fight with this army who is consisting of my own grandfather, my cousin brothers? And then he gives four reasons. In first chapter, we saw four reasons of Arjuna, which Arjuna gave to Krishna for not fighting. So the first reason was, how can I kill my relatives? False compassion. He was compassionate to his relatives. The second reason was, if I kill my relatives, how can I enjoy? How can there be happiness? Because the happiness comes from sharing. And if even if I win, and for sharing, if somebody is not, nobody is there, then how can I be happy? That was the second reason. And then third reason, that if I kill somebody, I'll become sinful. Sinful reaction will be there. And the fourth reason given by Arjun to Krishna for not fighting is, if I kill these people, the human beings, then women will become widows. If I kill men, then women will become widows. And because of that, what will happen? Because of that, Varna Sankara will be there. Varna Sankara means unwanted population will be there in this world. And because of that unwanted population, there will be chaos in a society. So that was the fourth reason. Now, ahead of this, अर्जुन टेल्स वन मोर रीजन टू कृष्णा इन भगवद गीता एंड इन पर्टिकुलरली द सेकेंड चैप्टर स्टार्ट्स बाय टेलिंग दैट कृष्णा इज अर्जुन इज टेलिंग टू कृष्णा ओ माई डियर कृष्णा दैट आई विल नॉट फेल इन डिसीजन इज देयर ही इज नॉट एबल टू टेक द डिसीजन वेदर टू फाइट और नो एंड जस्ट बिफोर दैट इन द स्टार्टिंग ऑफ द सेकेंड चैप्टर सी हियर आई विल शो दिस वर्स This is a particular verse in the starting of the. This was the end of the first chapter. Sanjaya uvacha evam ukta arjuna sakhe ratopasto upashvitaha visrijya sa sharam chapam shokavim samvigna manasaha. So what is told here? That Arjuna kept his bow aside. And then As soon as Dhritarashtra heard that Arjuna kept his bow aside, Dhritarashtra became happy. He told that now my half of the work is done. Just imagine, see here Dhritarashtra, how happy he became. Sanjay is telling to Dhritarashtra and he became happy. It is like in the beginning of a India-Pakistan match, Sachin Tendulkar is not ready to play the match. It is, you can say that Dhritarashtra is telling to Sanjaya that, oh, very nice. Now Arjun will not fight. But then immediately in a as Madhu, what do you mean by Madhusudana? Madhusudan means one who is a killer of the doubts. Madhusudan means he is a killer of the doubts. So whatever doubt Arjun may have, Sanjay is telling to Dhritarashtra, don't become so happy because now our table. Now is it clear? Somebody can tell me in comments. Still
हरे कृष्णा प्रभु जी, अनेबल टू लिसन टू यू।
कृष्णा हरे कृष्णा, नाउ इज इट क्लियर? आई होप इट इज क्लियर नाउ। ओके, थैंक यू वेरी मच, सॉरी फॉर द इंटरनेट प्रॉब्लम, प्लीज फॉरगिव। सो दिस मटेरियल वर्ल्ड इज लाइक दिस। कृष्णा आल्सो टेल्स दैट दिस इज दुखालयम एंड अशाश्वतम। जस्ट बिफोर दिस क्लास almost for half an hour, 45 minutes, I was testing everything and everything was working fine. Even video and everything was working fine. And as soon as we started the session, book down. So now with this understanding, we'll go ahead in our second chapter. So in this particular chapter, we'll see four important lessons. First is G-I-T-A. Gita. So please try to remember this acronym, Gita. That will be the our lesson from this chapter. So you can see here, G means Guru, the absolute need of Guru. That is the full form of G. Now what had happened was, Arjuna became very, very depressed. And Krishna said, Shri Bhagavan Uvacha Kutastvam Kashmanam Idam Vishame Samupasthitam Anaryam Jushtam Ashwayam Akirti Karam Arjuna. So Krishna is telling to Arjuna that, oh Arjuna, from where these impurities came upon you? Why are you becoming like a eunuch? You are acting like a third gender. This is not behooving you. This is not a kshatriya what he is supposed to do. Anarya jishtam. Krishna was telling, in short, Krishna is telling to Arjuna that before this battle, you have won many, many battles. And now if you give up, then what will happen to your reputation? Whole world will laugh at you. Klebhyamasma gatam spartha, from where these impurities came upon you? Like that Krishna is asking to Arjuna. Is Klebhyamasma gatam partha? And why Krishna is calling Arjuna as partha? Because partha means, why Krishna, Arjuna is called as partha? Because Arjuna's mother's name is Pritha. That is why Arjuna's name is partha. And then why Krishna is calling Krishna as a partha? Because he is reminding Arjuna that, see, your mother, she has undergone so many miseries and so many troubles. She is so wonderful lady of good character and courage. And you are her son. How can you give up now? And how come these impurities can come upon you? So whoever is having any doubts, they are asking me on chat, will hold on these doubts till the end of the session. Okay, so till around 45 to 50 minutes we'll discuss, and then I'll open up for question answer. That time you can ask the questions. Till that time you can note down your questions, otherwise you may forget. Okay, so like this, Krishna is calling to Arjuna that you are partha, you are son of Pritha, and how come these impurities come upon you? And then Krishna tells to Arjuna, what are the duties of a kshatriya?
What are the duties to be performed by the Kshatriya? To protect citizen from all difficulties, this is the duty of a Kshatriya. Apply violence for a law and order. So many people say that violence is not required. But that is not the case. Violence has to be applied where it is necessary. Violence also has a place. Some people, they artificially try to negate the violence from the society. Like Srila Prabhupada also, once what happened, he was discussing with one of the Buddhist preacher, and Buddhist was saying, no, ahimsa is parama dharma. Prabhupada is telling him, no, yes, ahimsa is dharma, but where himsa is required, there it has to be applied. And that Buddhist person was saying, no, himsa has no place. And then Prabhupada asked him a question. Prabhupada is the founder of ISKCON. He asked him a question. That suppose you are going with your lady disciples on the road, and some of the hoodlums, some of the gundas, they catch hold of you, some of your lady disciples. Then what will you do? He said, no, I will not do anything. And then this lady disciple, they heard, what guru, Guruji, you will not do anything. And then Prabhupada asked him, this is not proper. If somebody attacks your disciples or ladies, then we have to imply violence. And here we see Kauravas have crossed their limit. Kauravas had crossed their limit of their violence and their doing, harming the Pandavas. They have poisoned Bhima and they tried to disrupt Draupadi. They kept fire to the house of Pandavas. So that is why Krishna was telling to Arjuna that your Kshatriya duty is there and that you have to perform properly. And then Arjun may ask, Arjun had a further doubts that how can I counteract in a battle men like Bhishma and Drona who are worthy of my worship? And then Arjun was saying that better I live by begging than to kill such great souls like Bhishma and Drona. And then he says that I do not know what is better for me. And then Krishna became confused. Should I dutifully fight and risk unnecessary violence? What Arjuna was confused about? These are the confusions given by Arjuna. Then should I refrain and live by begging? Victory is anyways uncertain. I don't know whether I will become victorious or I will die. And victory is also defeat because I will be living on the by killing my relatives. So even if I win, it will be as good as my death only, or it is as good as defeat only. So these are the doubts of Arjuna. And then he became confused. And that time he surrenders to Krishna. Now this is the most important point here is coming. The surrender of Arjun to Krishna. Till now, Arjun and Krishna, they were having a friendly talk. Arjun was telling some doubts and Krishna was just listening and smiling. Krishna was telling Arjun, okay, tell what more you want to tell. And then ultimately now Arjun understood that friendly talk will not help. This friendly talk is not going to help. I have to accept Krishna as my guru. And then only I can accept instruction from Krishna. And by applying those instructions in my life will be perfect. So here, this 2.7 shloka, which is the sar of this first part of our today chapter, Gita. So G means guru, the need of a guru. So let us recite this shloka after me. All of you can recite this particular shloka after me. कार्पण्य दोष पहत स्वभाव पृच्छामि त्वां धर्म सम्मूढचेता यश्रेयसान्निश्चितं ब्रूहि तन्मे शिष्यस्तेहं शादिमान् त्वां प्रपन्नम्। So what Arjun is telling to Krishna, that due to miserly weakness, karpanya dosha pahata swabhavam, due to miserly weakness, I am afflicted. And now I am asking you, pruchhami tvam dharma sammudacheta. Oh Krishna, I am asking you, what is real dharma? What should I do? Yashreyasan mishitam bruhitanve. Tell me for certain what is best for me. Shishyasteham shadhi maam tvam prapanyam. Now, I have taken shelter at your lotus feet. I have accepted you, my guru. Please instruct me. Like this, Arjuna is saying to Krishna. Now, one may say, okay, guru is required only for some things or some time or for some things. But no, guru is essential and important for everything. In every aspect of our life, Guru is very, very necessary and important. We see, even for a running, there are coaches, isn't it? Like the famous runner of India is P.T. Usha. Even she has a coach. Now one may wonder that what is the need for running? What is the need of coach for running? Many people run from here to there. In our childhood, all of us ran so much in our school. But still, coach is required for running also. So why not coach is required for a spiritual subject matter? We cannot learn any knowledge without a teacher. Even in our college, schools, we accept a teacher. So similarly, to understand a spiritual subject matter, a teacher is very much important. And teacher should be a qualified and bona fide teacher. Teacher cannot be anybody and everybody cannot become a teacher. Teacher should have his own teacher. Who is a bona fide teacher or who is an actual teacher? He should come in Guru Parampara. One who is like autonomous and he says, oh, today one fine day, some light came in my brain and now I am a self-realized soul. I got a sakshatkar. Now listen from me. No, that person is not a guru. Guru means who have understood the subject matter nicely from his spiritual master. And like this is a disciplic succession should be there. That is why guru is required. So now all of you have chosen, all of you have done a very wonderful choice. That all of you have chosen to attend this course and hear from different teachers, those who are coming in proper Guru Parampara system. ISKCON is connected to Brahma Gaudiya Guru Shishya Sampradaya. ISKCON is not an autonomous organization. This is Parampara directly coming from Krishna. That is the beauty of ISKCON and Srila Prabhupada, who is the founder of ISKCON. So this is very wonderful thing what all of you have done. In lockdown, everybody is locked up in a home. Many people are doing many things on their internet, Facebook, WhatsApp, and YouTube. Many students are wasting their time, lot of time on mobiles. So instead of doing all those things, it is best that all of you have chosen to attend this Gita Saram course. That is very nice. Now, this is the best online platform which is going on. So now, after this, then our Arjuna, he surrendered to Krishna and Krishna accepts Arjuna as his disciple. So now, before also Krishna and Arjuna were together. Before also Krishna and Arjuna were together, but still Arjuna could not get the knowledge from Krishna. Why? Because he was not connected with Krishna. Physically he was with Krishna, but he was away from Krishna. He was not ready to align with Krishna. But now in the 7th verse, he accepted Krishna as his guru and he connected himself. So now all of you are connecting through this internet medium. This is a very wonderful thing. So many naughty children, they forgetful of living entities and they become attracted to glittering illusion of false beauty and objects of this material world. But that is not all in all. And that is why they don't feel that there is a need of a guru. So in first part, we saw that there is an essential, absolute necessity of a guru in our life to understand this subject matter. So Sudarshan is asking that which Guru Parampara is going to belong to? Brahma, Madhva, Gaudiya, Guru, Shishya, Sampradaya. Now next part we'll see I. Identity. Who are we actually? This is the next part which Krishna is explaining to Arjuna. And this is from where the spiritual life starts. See, this is where Krishna started his instructions to Arjuna. So spiritual life starts from understanding our identity. Who am I? Now if I ask you a question, who are you? Generally, people tell their name. My name is Mahaprabhu Chaitanya Das. Somebody may say that my name is Sudarshan. Or somebody may say that my name is Suresh. Or Shyamala. Or like that, different answers they may give. But you got your name after name giving ceremony. Isn't it? Before that, who we were? We were something else. Isn't it? So, we have to know that what is our real identity. If I ask you, who are you? You may probably give that this body. But according to Dr. Harry Monson, that our body is made up of calcium, iron, phosphate and different things. And the cost of our body is just 110 rupees. Is that... Do you think that we are made up of only this item, calcium, iron, phosphate? So many chemicals we throw in gutters when we do some chemical experiment in our 11th, 12th. But nobody punishes us. But if I pick up some person and throw him out of the window, then I'll be put behind the bars. And I may tell police, oh, I'm just throwing some chemicals. Police will slap me and tell, oh, he is not just a chemical, he is a human being. So this is, what is the difference between just a chemical bag and a human being? We are not just made of chemicals, but something else. Like, this supposed beauty queen. Now, when she dies, chemicals are same, but there is no feeling, no desires, no thinking, no movements, no willing, no consciousness. Body same, but what is not there? The soul is gone. That is the problem. And now Krishna is telling in Bhagavad Gita that for the soul there is neither birth nor a death. Anytime. He has not come into being and does not come into being. So soul just moves from one body to another body. So this is what Krishna told to Arjuna. Natvevaham jatunasam natvam neme janadhipa nachayavana bhavishamaha sarve vayam athaparam. So Arjuna, might argue that although the soul is eternal, body is related to the soul. So Krishna is telling to Arjuna that natvevaham datunasam, that there was not a time when neither I was there, means always you were also existing and I am also existing. That is what Krishna is telling to Arjuna, that it is never all the time where you are not there and I am not there. We are always existing. This is the 12th verse. Na chaivana bhavishyamah sarve vayam atah param. So when soul leaves this body, body is fed to the fire, but soul moves from one body to another body. And what is the proof? Here is the next shloka given in Bhagavad Gita. Dehi nosmin yatha dehe kaumaram yovanam jara tatha dehantara praptir dhiras tatrana muhyati. So soul moves from one body to another body. As is like, suppose now I am wearing this shirt. So this, if this shirt becomes torn and veered off, then I will give up this shirt and accept the new one. Hare Krishna. So some of you are asking some questions and comments in the chat. So here, some of you are asking that why PPT is obstructing the video. So where my video is there, there is nothing behind the PPT. That is one clarification. And second thing is, if you want to see only PPT and if you want to see only my video, there you have to do setting in your laptop. From my side, everything is clear. Okay. And some of you are asking why I'm stopping in between, because some of you are asking questions. That is why I'm stopping in between. So let us go ahead now. So the change of body is eternal. As we give up this body, this shirt, and accept the new one, similarly, when our body becomes useless, then the soul gives up this body and accepts the new one. Soul is eternal. Like from childhood, our bodies have changed so much. When we were small, we were having this much body. And now our body has grown up so much. According to medical science, every 7 years, our bodily cells all are changing. But still, we remember the things which happened much before 7 years. Still now we remember what happened 10 years back, 12 years back. Now whole body is changed. Still something is, we are able to remember. Why? Because something is common, and that thing is soul. And that is what Krishna is telling to Arjuna in this particular verse, that don't worry, dehinosmin yatha dehe kaumaram yovanam jara, that soul is constant, and when body becomes useless, then he will accept the new body. Now one may wonder why Krishna started telling this knowledge of soul to Arjuna, because Arjuna asked Krishna that how can I kill my grandfather and my teacher? So here Krishna is telling to Arjuna that don't worry, even you may feel that you are not able to kill your grandfather and teacher, but they are not their body, they are the spirit soul. And even if you kill them, they are not going to be killed, because soul never dies. And now characteristics of the soul will be coming. So Krishna is telling to Arjuna that even though sometimes you may feel that little pain, sometimes you may feel little pain to lose your near and dear relatives, but you have to tolerate it. Because in this world, everybody has to tolerate some things. मात्र स्पर्श कौंतेय शीतोष्ण सुख दुखदा आगमा पायनो नित्यस तांतिदिशस्व भारत. सो हियर कृष्ण सेड टू अर्जुन, जस्ट एज अ लेडी हु इज कुकिंग इन द किचन, ही हैज टू टॉलरेट द हीट एंड द कोल्ड, एंड इन समर शी कुक्स नियर अ फायर, एंड अ योगीज दोज आर डूइंग तपस्या इन हिमालयस, दे आर टॉलरेटिंग द कोल्ड इन अ विंटर. Similarly, we have to tolerate the things in this world. And when we tolerate the thing, and sama dukkha sukham dhiram, when we become equanimous, or when there is equanimity in all the situation, then we will get liberation from this world. And then na jayate mriyate va kadachin nayam bhutva bhavitana bhuyam. अजो नित्यम शाश्वतो यम पुराणो न हन्यते हन्यमाने शरीरे. सो हियर कृष्णा इज क्लियरली टेलिंग टू अर्जुन दैट इवन द बॉडी मे डाई, इवन द बॉडी मे बी किल्ड, बट सोल कैन नॉट डाई. न हन्यते हन्यमाने शरीरे, दिस बॉडी मे गो बट सोल विल नॉट डाई. सो देर इज नो हार्म इन किलिंग द्रोण भीष्म एंड अदर पीपल. No one can kill the soul. Again, this verse comes that Vasamsi Jirnani Yatha Vihaya Navani Grinnani Naroparani Tatha Sharirani Vihaya Jirnani Anyani Samyati Navani Dehi. So, in this verse, again, clearly it is told. Now, Krishna is telling Arjuna the Jnana or Sankhya Yoga, analysis of body and soul. Krishna is analyzing the difference between body and a soul. Particularly, he is telling so changing of the body is similar to changing of the clothes. So this knowledge is given to Arjuna. And when we get this knowledge in our life also, our lamentation reduces a lot. Like for example, now when we lose our near and dear ones, then what will happen? We become very much depressed, isn't it? We don't know where they have gone. Or we feel that permanently separated, separation is there, isn't it? But when we understand they are not this body but spirit soul, then we get little relief. Okay, they have just changed the body and they have gone to some other body for residing. And also in our case also, when we get this knowledge of a soul, we also become little less anxious. Because everybody is fearful of a death. Why people are fearful of death? Because they don't know what is the future, what will happen to them in future. But if somebody is having the knowledge of soul, then he understands that he will get the next birth according to his karma, and that is why he has to do good karma now. Tatha shariyani vihaya jirnani. So this knowledge of soul is very, very important. Knowledge of identity. We should know who are we actually. Are we just this body or something else? So we are not just this body but a spirit soul. And scientifically also we can prove that. Like here, Dr. Ian Stevenson, he gives many proofs for the soul's existence. He tells these past life memories of many, many people. Here is the story of Shukla who became Meena in the next life. So these students, somebody may say that they are faking. They are telling lies because they want to become famous, so they are making some stories. Like that somebody may say, okay, somebody may tell some lies and some stories, but nobody can fake the skills which they have, isn't it? The skills which somebody has from childhood, nobody can fake them. Somebody can tell the fake stories that I was this man, I was Bill Gates in my previous life, or I was Shivaji Maharaj. Somebody may tell these lies, but nobody can tell, nobody can fake the skills which they have. And we can see, you can go and Google on YouTube or in Google, that there is one of the piano player, Karl Marx. His name is Karl Marx, and he's just a 4-year-old boy who is playing a piano so expertly that even a best of the masters of piano player cannot match him. And when somebody asked him that, how are you so expert? And he said that I am practicing since last 20 years. He is ages 4 years only, and he's practicing since last 20 years. How come so? Because he might have done that in his previous life. There are so many books which are published for this near-death experience and out-of-body experience, and previous life memories are there. So now let us move ahead. Another proof of existence of soul is phobia. See here, one boy is swimming so nicely in the water, another boy is crying. So he has a phobia of a water. He is fearful of a water, and he is not fearful of the water. Now, why this person is fearful of a water? Because he thinks, because he might have died in his last life because of drowning into the water. That is why he is having that phobia. So phobia also proves the existence of previous life and existence of a soul. Somebody may have phobia of knives. Somebody may have phobia of guns, because they may have died in their last life because of these things. Now another thing, what happens to us at the time of death? We give up this body and accept the new one. Now we will move to the third acronym, Gita, T. T means two dualities. Sorry, two duties, not dualities. Two duties. So we, all of us, we have two duties. Till now we saw G and I. G means the necessity of a guru, and I means identity. Now after understanding the identity, that I am not this body but spirit soul, then somebody may say, okay, then I need not to take care of my family, isn't it? Because I am a body, I am not this body, I am a soul. And they are different souls, so I don't have any responsibility. I don't have to take care of them. No, that is not a fact. We have this body and we are the soul. So we have two identities. Means we are the soul and we are covered by the body. So we have two duties. Duties related to this body and duties related to soul. So the duties which are on this bodily platform, like I have my mother, father, teachers, relatives. So whatever duty I have for them, because they are connected to my body, their duty is called as conditional duty. What their duty is called as? Conditional duty. Because I am in this condition now, I am in this body. So the duties related to this body is are called as conditional duties. And duties related to this soul are called as constitutional duties. So constitutional duties, like a vertical vector, that is a duty for the Lord, and conditional duties like a horizontal vector on this plane. That is the difference between conditional duty and constitutional duty. Constitutional duty means the vertical vector, and conditional duty means the horizontal vector. Duties related to this body are conditional duty. Duties related to the soul are constitutional duty. So let us see that in detail. Spiritual Swadharma. So that means Sanatan Dharma. The Dharma for the soul is called as, Dharma for the soul is called as Sanatan Dharma, and Dharma for the body is called as conditional duty or material Swadharma. Now, what do you mean by dharma? Actually, dharma does not mean religion. People, because nowadays people, they term religion as some faith, but faith can be changed. But dharma means intrinsic characteristic of something. Like the dharma of a salt is to be salty. Dharma of sugar is to be sweet. And dharma of a fire is to give heat and light. Similarly, the dharma of a soul is to love and serve. What is the dharma of a soul? To love and serve. That is the dharma of a soul. That is the characteristic of a soul. Like here you can see, everybody is serving somebody else. The shopkeeper is serving, this person is serving his dog, parents are serving their sons, daughters. But this service ends at the time of death. So the dharma of soul is to love and serve God. In this world, when paycheck is stopped, service will stop. We see, when somebody is working in a company and a boss does not pay that person, then that person will not serve any longer. Isn't it? But service to the Krishna, our Lord, is not like that. That service continues. That is eternal service. So God is eternal, soul is eternal, and their loving relationship is eternal. But in this world, we see the relationships in this world are temporary. That is why if we love and serve God, then that is eternal dharma. That is our real dharma. That is Sanatan dharma. So here example is given, just as a man suffering from amnesia forgets his parents, similarly we have forgotten to love and serve God. Now we don't remember who is God and why should I serve him, why should I obey him, because we have forgotten these things. We have forgotten our relationship with Krishna, and we have to revive that relationship. And how to revive that relationship is by hearing about the Lord, by chanting about the Lord, by chanting the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. We can revive that lost relationship with the Lord. So performing prescribed duty gives enjoyment. So now, till 30th verse we saw that Krishna was telling Arjuna about the science of soul, that you are not this body but the spirit soul. But now, okay, Arjuna may say, no, no, I don't believe on this. So then Krishna is telling that if you do your own duty, then also you'll be happy. So dharma api chaviksha na vikam pitum arhasi dharma dadhi yudhashreyasna kshatriyasya na vidyate. Krishna is telling to Arjuna that you are kshatriya and you will be happy only by performing your duty. If you go out, you are thinking that you will live by begging. But if you go and beg, and if somebody does not give you any alms or anything in return, then you will take out your sword and kill that person. Thak. So that is not the duty for a kshatriya. Kshatriya cannot beg from others. The duty for kshatriya is to fight. Kshat. Kshat means the weapon. And triya means one who uses the power to bring out law and order in a society. That is called a kshatriya. So Krishna is saying to Arjuna that you are a kshatriya. It is best for you to perform your duty. And if you perform your duty, then you will go to Swarga. But if you neglect your duty, then you will incur the pap or sin. And there will be infamy. People will say wrong words to you. People will criticize you. So instead of accepting the criticism, it is better for you to perform your duty nicely. Now we have seen the different reasons for Krishna, different reasons given by Arjuna not to fight, and Krishna is refuting his reasons step by step. So first reason given by Arjuna for not to fight is compassion for the friends. So then Krishna is telling to Arjuna that don't worry. Why are you compassionate for their bodies? But their bodies are temporary. See, here Krishna is telling to Arjuna, soul and body is different, is there. So if you feel your compassion for your friends, so don't worry about that. They are not going to die, because there is a difference between soul and body. Soul is eternal. Then Arjuna is telling that, how can I enjoy the victory without my relatives? That was the second reason for Arjuna not to fight. Then Krishna told him that performing your duty is the real happiness. Real happiness is in performing your duty. And then third reason given by Arjuna was, if I kill people, then I will get sinful reaction. But Krishna is telling to Arjuna that if you don't perform your duty of Kshatriya, and if you don't perform your spiritual duty, then that is a sin. What is a spiritual duty? Spiritual duty means to obey the order of Krishna. That is a spiritual duty for us. And if you don't do that, then sin will be there. In killing, there is no sin. And the example is given is of soldiers. When soldiers, they go to fight on the battlefield. So even if they kill the many, many soldiers of opponent party, then they will be rewarded with the Paramvir Chakra and Ashok Chakra by that. But if same soldier kills the citizen, then he will be put behind the bars. So similarly, when somebody fights on the order of authorities like Krishna, then they will never get a sin. Like here, Krishna said to Arjuna that if you fight on my behalf, then you will not get any sin. And then you are asking about destruction of family tradition. So now Krishna will tell to Arjuna that you should be attached to Krishna, not to Vedic rituals. Family rituals may go on, the traditions may be there, but one should be attached to Krishna, not to Vedic rituals. That answer is given in verse number 45 and 46. And then the fifth reason given by Arjuna to Krishna was indecision. Indecision means I'm not able to take the decision. So answer is given in verse number 41, that surrender to Guru and Krishna and do your duty. And by that, you'll be able to take the proper decision. Like here in the 37th verse. So benefit is there in either way. Even if you think that you are this body, still if you kill Bhishma and Drona, then you will get the kingdom. And if you understand that they are not this body but spirit soul, then they will get a new body to stay in. Isn't it? So fight as a duty. And he is telling that by buddhi yoga, by understanding this knowledge of soul, you cut off this attachment. Karma bandham prahasyati. So when we understand this knowledge of soul, then we understand that they are not going to die. And with that, we can cut off this bandhana, which is holding us down in this world. And now, what do you mean by yoga, or what do you mean by accepting the order of Krishna? So when we accept the order of Krishna and Guru, then that is the meaning of actual bhakti yoga. And when we perform that bhakti yoga, there is no loss. Even though we may not be able to perfect that yoga, but there is no loss in that yoga system. And here is the verse. Neha bikramana shosti pratyavayo na vidyate स्वल्पमपि यस्य धर्मस्य त्रायते महतो भयात्। सो कृष्ण इज टेलिंग टू अर्जुन, अर्जुन इफ यू लिसन टू मी देन यू विल नॉट फॉल डाउन। नेहा विक्रम नाशस्य प्रत्यवायो न विद्यते। एंड लिटिल बिट एंडेवर ऑन दिस पाथ, विच इज द पाथ विच इज गिवन बाय कृष्ण, लिटिल बिट एंडेवर ऑन दिस पाथ विल गिव यू इमेंस बेनिफिट। त्रायते महतो भयात्। From the greatest of the danger, you will be saved. And what is the greatest danger? The greatest danger is going down in a hellish life or going down to the animal species. That is the greatest danger. And you will be saved from that if we walk on the path given by Krishna to us. And one who is intelligent, he has his focused attention. Like here is the example is given of this runner who don't have both the legs, but he stood first in Olympics 2016. So vyavsayatmika buddhi ekeha kuru nandana bahushakha anantascha buddhayo avyavsayinam. So Krishna is telling to Arjuna that those who are on this path, the path given by me, the Bhakti Yoga, their intelligence is single branched or absolute. Their intelligence is not many branched. They don't go here and there. They follow the path perfectly. And if somebody diverts here, there, Bahu Shaka Anantascha, if he goes here and there, then he will not be able to reach the goal. So our intelligence should be one pointed. It should not be many branched. And then Krishna is telling ahead that when we have our intelligence single, like focused, then we can cross over the obstacles. The obstacles which are there in this path, we can cross them over by this vyavasayatmika intelligence. And for that, the verse 44th verse is there. Bhoga aishwarya prasaktana taya aparita chetasam vyavasayatmika buddhi samadhana vidyate. So see, this person is sense controlled. His intelligence is one pointed, pointed towards Krishna, following the path given by Krishna. So he can say no to the temptations. See here, he is able to say no to the temptations. But a person whose intelligence is many branched, he is not focused. So then he will fall prey to the bad habits. So when one is attached to bhoga and aishwarya, bhoga means tendency to enjoy and aishwarya means the opulences. When one is attached to these things, then he cannot have one-pointed attention. When one is attached to these things, then he cannot have one-pointed attention. So now this is the very famous shloka in Bhagavad Gita. Many people, they recite this shloka. Karmanyevadhikaraste ma phaleshu kadachana ma karma phale heturbhur mate sangostva karmani. Now you may wonder, sir, what is, or Prabhu, what is this photo given here? So here all of these ladies, they are waiting for a lift and they are pressing a lift button, isn't it? Now once we press the lift button, lift knows that I have to come. But what we do, we again and again press. So this is the meaning of this verse, that we have the right to perform our duty. Karmane evadhikaraste. We have right to perform our duty. But the results are given by Krishna. Ma karma phala hetur bhur mate sangostva karmani. So we have sorry, just a minute. So we have right to perform our prescribed duty, but we are not entitled to the results of the action. The actions we have to offer to Krishna. And ma karma phala hetru bhur mate sangatva stva akarmani. So never consider that, you should not consider that I am the cause of the results of our activity. These results are given to us by Krishna. Like here, this lift is there. Now, as soon as we press the button, lift will not come. It will come properly when the time comes. So similarly, we have freedom to perform a duty, but results are given to us by Krishna, and we have to engage those results in the service of Krishna. So here is the famous example of Hanumanji, who has engaged all his resources in the service of Krishna. So we have to be detached from the results, not from the goals. So we have to perform our duty, but don't be attached to the results. Now about this Nishkama Karma Yoga, and that will also come in the subsequent chapters when we go ahead. In third chapter, fourth and fifth chapter, it will come more. There is one more section, the important section is remaining in this chapter. We'll cover that now. That is A. A means Atmaram, Sthita Prajna. Who is Sthita Prajna? Sthita Prajna means self-realized person. So now, Krishna is explaining to Arjuna that who is the person who is equipoised and a sthita prajna, who is Atmaram. The characteristic of that person is coming in subsequent verses now. So why Krishna is explaining this verse? After hearing about intelligence or fixed intelligence, Arjuna asks Krishna, so what is the characteristic of a person whose intelligence is fixed? What are the qualities of the liberated soul or Jivan Mukta? That is asked by Arjuna to Krishna. That how to understand that who is having this fixed intelligence? So this is the question asked by Arjuna. Sita Prajnasya ka bhasha. Kim prabhasaye, kim asita, kim vrajet. So this is the verse of Sita Prajna. This is the question asked by Arjun to Krishna. And Krishna answered them wonderfully in these different verses. So what is the general symptoms of a Sita Prajna or self-realized person? So first and foremost principle or first and foremost qualification of a sthita prajna is that he gives up all material desires of sense gratification, born of material concoction. So a self-realized person don't have any material desires which are born from sense gratification. Sense gratification means people want to enjoy their own senses. What do you mean by sense gratification? Like all of us, we have 5 knowledge acquiring senses and 5 working senses. So people generally, they try to gratify these senses. Like eyes want to see beautiful form, ears want to hear some rock or pop music, tongue want to taste very delicious food, nose want to smell nice fragrance, eggs, denim, this, that. And our skin, it want to touch soft objects. So that is the meaning of sense gratification. So the general symptoms of a self-realized person or a pure devotee is that he gives up this desire for sense gratification, which is born of mental concoction. So people think that they will be happy if they gratify their senses. But that is only a thought. They just think it. Actually, they don't become happy by gratifying the senses. It is like a putting of fuel in a fire that will grow more and more. If we try to feed our senses, senses will never say no. Senses will say, give me more, give me more, give me more. So how to get rid of that? We have to purify our mind and find satisfaction in the self. So we have to purify our mind from this tendency of material sense gratification. This tendency of trying to enjoy independent of Krishna, that we have to give up. And then we have to know what is the love for Lord for us and our Lord love for the Lord. And then next, second question asked by Arjuna was, how does he speak? So he speaks that his speech is very much his speech will not affect others. And he will be equipoised in happiness and distress. And he will be free from attachment, fear and anger. That is how will be the speech of a self-realized person. And he speaks only for Krishna, only about Krishna, and only spreading Krishna consciousness. That is how a self-realized person speaks. And the example is given is of a Jada Bharat. That he speaks only for the pleasure of the Lord. And then the third question was asked about sitting and that how he behaves or how does he sits. So the answer is given in a verse number 58 that a pure devotee or Sthita Prajna person is like a tortoise. You are able to see the tortoise here in the picture. So the beauty of tortoise is that whenever there is a danger, the tortoise will withdraw its senses. And when there is no danger, the tortoise will expand all its senses in all the direction. Means he will take out his hands, his head and legs. So a Sthita Prajna devotee or a person is like a tortoise. Like now, when somebody comes into temple, how he should keep his senses? He should keep his senses open. Eye should be open to take the darshan of the Lord. Ear should be open to hear the kirtan of the Lord. Then nose should be open to smell the incense of the Lord. Mouth should be open to speak about the Lord. But when somebody goes to market or a mall, then his eyes should be closed. Ear should not hear nonsense things. Because if you take garbage inside, garbage will come out. If you take good inside, good will come out. Isn't it? So that is how a Sthita Prajna person behaves. And he is totally sense controlled. He eats only in Govindas and nowhere else. That is the property or that is the characteristic of a Sthita Prajna person. So here the analogy is given of a chariot driver and a charioteer. So here these five senses are there. Eyes, nose, ears, tongue and touch. And these reins are like a mind. And the driver is like a intelligence and a passenger is a soul. So a sthitaparinya person, he control his senses by the agency of mind, by intelligence. This is our control, and then soul will can go to his destination. But we cannot control our senses just like that. We cannot just hold on to our senses. We cannot say every time no, 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 no. Like that we cannot say. So we have to have some higher engagement. Like for example, a beggar is having a dry chapati. If a beggar is having a dry chapati, and I ask that beggar, "Hey, throw away that dry chapati." Then will that beggar throw that dry chapati? No, that beggar will not throw. But if I give that beggar gulab jamun, then that beggar can throw that dry chapati, isn't it? Similarly is our condition. We have many, many anarthas in our heart and many, many bad things. So unless and until we have some higher engagement, some higher things to hold on to, we cannot give up the lower things. And as soon as we get taste in Krishna consciousness, we'll automatically give up the lower things of this world. So sense control is possible only and only by developing devotion to the Lord. That is the only way by which we can understand that is the only way by which we can control our senses. Like here, example is given is of Ajamil in Srimad Bhagavatam 3rd canto. This particular example comes of Ajamil, that how he saw the prostitute and a Shudra person enjoying, and then he could not control his senses because he did not had a higher engagement in a life. That is again and again those thoughts were coming, and then he indulged into that prostitute. So the common process of fall down, how we fall down is, first we contemplate upon the objects. Dhyayato vishayam pumsam, how we divert our attention from the goal is given here. Dhyayato vishayam pumsam, first and foremost we contemplate on the sense object. Then we develop sangateshas jate, we develop attachment for those objects. And then lust. Lust means I want it, I want it, I want it. And if lust is fulfilled, then there will be greed. And if lust is not fulfilled, then there will be anger. So in the 62nd and 63rd shloka, Krishna is explaining to Arjuna that how does a person how does a person gets bewildered in this world, and how does he lose his discrimination that is given? So Krishna is saying that first and foremost he contemplates upon the objects of gratification. Then he develops attachment. Like suppose somebody, some of your friend gets a car. Then you contemplate, oh, I should also get a car. I should also have a car. And that leads to attachment. Yes, we become to the particular car. So I want Baleno or Verna or Mercedes-Benz or BMW. And then there is a lust, that adamant desire to acquire that object. And in that, if that desire is not fulfilled, then it leads to anger. And if the desire is fulfilled, then it leads to greed. Suppose somebody gets a new mobile, then he will not be satisfied on that. As soon as he sees some other mobile with friend, then immediately a desire comes, oh, I should have that mobile. This mobile I should not have. So that is what Krishna is explaining ahead. And how does he walk? Always engages his senses in the service of the Lord. That is how he engages his senses. Here the question is asked that how does a sense control person or a sthitaparinya person engages his senses. So sthitaparinya person engages his senses in the service of the Lord. how he engages his senses. He takes only the food which is offered to the Lord. He engages his hands in the cleaning the temple of the Lord. And then what is the result of achieving the Lord's mercy? We'll be completely satisfied. Everybody is looking for the satisfaction in this world, isn't it? So when we surrender to Lord and obey his laws, then we can be satisfied in this world. So, and if somebody is not engaging in the service of the Lord, then he cannot find peace either in this world or in next world. Nasti buddhir ayuktasya na chayuktasya bhavana na chabhya vaya shanti ashantasya kuta sukam. That no happiness and peace for the person who lacks of Krishna consciousness. Like here is the example given is of Saubhuri Muni. Saubhuri Muni, he was under the water doing tapasya. But because he was not engaged in the service of Krishna, he was just doing impersonal meditation. So he fell down. He got attracted just by seeing two fishes mating and got bewildered. So without Krishna consciousness, we cannot have a proper peace. So the conclusion of this chapter is that G-I-T-A. G-I-T-A means, G means the essential need of a guru, and I means our identity, T means two duties, and A means Atmaram, or who is Sthita Prajna. So we saw what are the two, G means Guru's need. Everybody needs a Guru in his life. So we have to find a bona fide Guru. I means identity. Who are we? We are the soul, but not the body. And that is why we have two duties, conditional and constitutional. And then Atmaram, Sthita Prajna. Who, what are the characteristics of a people, those who attend this pure devotional service? That was discussed in the last portion. So as time is limited, we could not take the whole this portion. If you have any doubts, we'll be sending you a particular link on which you can write down your questions. Or you can also, we are trying to develop a portal where you can speak out your questions, audio, and we'll receive them and we'll answer back. Either record them in audio form or type and give it to you. So now we are opening here officially when we end today's session. So thank you very much, Hare Krishna. Whoever have doubts, they can stay back. They can ask their doubts. I am available. But officially here we end our session. So those who want to leave, they can leave. And those who want to ask question, they can raise their hand electronically. I will unmute you. You can ask the questions and I will try to answer them. So here is a question from Galaxy M31. Yes, you can unmute yourself and ask a question.
Yeah, Prabhuji, like we were talking about the soul actually. So when actually we leave this body, so the soul is going to another body, or probably we go to Vaikuntha if it happens to be.
It depends upon what is the desire soul has acquired.
Correct, correct. But, and let me just how punishment is
body. Your audio is not clear.
Wrong.
Hare Krishna, your audio is not clear.
Prabhuji, could you get my question?
Now I am able to hear. Can you speak?
Yeah, what I'm telling is, like, case of the soul is body and goes to other body. There is a transformation of the soul, okay, to other body. But whatever the sins are there, how that punishment is undergone?
So when soul goes from one body to another body, it is not that immediately it goes. Okay. For some particular time, a period, it is a period of 3 days, it goes to, it accepts a preta body. And that preta body is taken to a hell and sufferings are given in the hell, and then he accepts the new body. So there is an intermediate thing in between. That soul, when somebody dies, according to his karma, he accepts the preta body and then he goes to hell, suffers there, and then accepts the new body. Okay, in chat, there are some questions. I am having a question. Could you please unmute me? Those who are having questions, they can raise hand. Then you will come on the top and then I can unmute you. So here, Sudarshan, you have a question? You can unmute yourself, Sudarshan. Unmute.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji.
Yes.
Prabhuji, you said that Arjuna is called as Partha because his mother name was Pridana, Prabhuji.
Yes.
Prabhuji, in general, in Mahabharata, they said, they will be saying that Pancha Pandava's mothers was Kunti and Madri, Prabhuji.
Yes, yes. So Kunti's another name is Pritha also. You may have your name Sudarshan in a school and your parents may call you some other name, Chinna or something like that at home. Isn't it? So Arjun had many, many names.
Ekadat, Prabhuji.
Okay.
What is exact meaning of the word Krishna, Prabhuji?
Krishna means one who attracts and gives a pleasure. Krish means one who attracts. Na means one who gives pleasure. That is the meaning of Krishna. Okay.
Dhanyavad, Prabhuji. Hare Krishna.
Dhanyavad. Hare Krishna. Now, Galaxy. Galaxy, his name is. You can ask a question.
What is the difference between the conditional duty and
little louder, please?
Conditional duty.
Little louder. Yes.
Difference between conditional duty and constitutional duty. Once will you explain?
What is the difference between conditional duty and constitutional duty? See, the duties related to this body is called as conditional. Duties related to soul is called as constitutional. Now, what is the duty for a soul? You consider it like a bird in a cage. So, cage is there. Cage also you have to clean and bird also you have to feed. So, we are this body. It is like a cage and bird, inside bird is like a soul. So, now duty for a soul is to love and serve Krishna. To offer worship to Krishna. To chant his holy names. To serve the devotees of Krishna. That is the duty for the soul. And the duty on the platform of body means you have your mother, father. Now somebody may have husband, wife. So duty towards husband, wife, duty towards mother, father, that is duty on the bodily platform because they are our mother, father related to this body. They are our wife, children related to this body. So duty towards them, like if some husband is there, he has to earn the money. He cannot say, no, you are not this body, you are spirit soul. So now you do everything on your own. I will not earn the money. Just take the air and live. That is not the way we say. Okay. So we have these two duties. Conditional and constitutional.
Dhanyavad Prabhuji.
Hare Krishna. Now 19RO A1A. You can ask the question.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji.
Hare Krishna, yes.
Dandat Pranam, Prabhuji.
Haan.
Prabhuji, can I ask question, Prabhuji, in
yes,
Telugu?
Yes. You can ask me in Hindi or English.
अब मैं हिंदी में पूछ सकता हूँ प्रभु जी आपको?
हाँ हिंदी में पूछ सकते हैं।
हाँ प्रभु जी आप बोले कि आत्मा है बोले ना प्रभु जी, दो टाइप के आत्मा है, एक सुप्रीम और एक अमर आत्मा है ना बोले ना जी, सुपर सो हाउ। तो मैं क्या पूछना चाहता हूँ कि मैं कैसा अंदर का सुप्रीम का आत्मा मैं कैसा सुन सकता हूँ, क्योंकि अब मेरे को कुछ काम करने का है। समथिंग फर्स्ट इफ आई गो टू सुप्रीम प्लेस means when lottery ticket means my inside soul will tell do not buy, but another side it will buy, your luck may come. So how can hear the supreme voice inside my soul? How can hear?
We can, in our conditioned state we cannot hear the supreme voice. We have to obey the order of guru, and our gurus never told us to play a lottery. That is gambling, that is against the shastras. So please
just
don't play lottery.
Just I take an example.
Yes, yes.
But how I can hear the supreme voice from anything which I'm doing?
You know the example of radio. We fine tune the radio to get a particular station, isn't it? So the by fine tuning, we can reach to a particular station. Now how to fine tune ourselves so that we can hear the voice of Paramatma? That is your question. In radio, we have knob. So you are asking, what is that our knob by which we can understand what is the desire of Krishna? So we can understand the desire of Krishna by reading about him in Bhagavad Gita.
Yes,
now we don't know exactly what Krishna is telling us. So when we read Bhagavad Gita, then we can ask, we can understand the what is the Paramatma, what is Paramatma want to tell. Yes, Kiran, you can unmute yourself. I could see your hand.
Okay, Dandak Pranam Prabhuji. Dhanyava.
Sorry, again unmute. Sorry. Yes, Kiran. Now you can ask.
Hare Krishna, Prabhu.
Hare Krishna.
Prabhu, you said that we should... we should focus on goals. We should not focus on results. I mean, we have to leave the results, but we have to work. Both materially and spiritually, we have to obey the only the focus on the goals, and we should not concentrate on the results. Both spiritual work and material work.
Yes, both spiritual and material. Actually, we have to see. Yes. We have to focus on goal in the sense. I told that we have a right to perform a duty. We have a right to perform a duty, but we are not entitled for the results. Or results are in the hand of Krishna. Now I may study a lot, but yes, results are not in my hand, isn't it? And knowledge, forgetfulness, everything is given by Krishna to us. Now, for example, a farmer may sow seeds in a field, but whether crops to come or no, it depends upon the rains, it depends on different factors. But this is the meaning of that verse, that we have to do our duty, dutifully. We cannot say, anyway, results are in the hand of Krishna. They will come, no problem. I'll just sit. After hearing Bhagavad Gita, Arjun fought. He did not sit on the chariot and said, Krishna, anyway, you are Supreme Lord, fight now. What is my need? Arjun did not say like that. So understanding this, we work as if with full responsibility, we work. Okay, is it clear? Is that answers your question?
No, actually, how practically it works, Prabhu, because we do work, definitely we expect result. If we don't expect result, sometimes we feel bad. How can we overcome this situation practically?
Okay.
How it works?
Yes, yes. See, why we want results? Because we want to show up to others. Isn't it? Why we want to come first in a class? Because we want to show to our parents, our relatives. See, I came first. But nobody sees the endeavors, isn't it? In this world, nobody sees the endeavors. They just see the results. Because this world is made in such a way that results are more important than the endeavors. But Krishna does not see that. Krishna sees the endeavors, how much endeavors we are putting. So we see in the terms of Krishna. We don't see in the terms of this world. This world is made in that way. So we don't have to worry about this world too much. So stop worry and start living. So practically we focus on endeavors. Because Krishna is pleased by endeavors. He is not pleased by the results. Because results are not in our hand. Results are in the hand of Krishna.
Endeavors means what, Prabhu? Endeavors.
Endeavors means prayatna. See, you have duty to perform work. See, if you are a student, then your endeavors are to study. You have to study 8-10 hours a day. That is endeavors. Krishna is pleased by that. Like suppose you are a mother. Then your endeavors are to raise your children in a such a way that they become a devotee of Krishna. Whether they become devotee of Krishna or no, that is not in your hand. You may tell them many things, they will not listen. But if you try your best to make them devotee, that is in your hand. Now you understood what do you mean by endeavors? So you perform your endeavors. Bring them to temple, put them into value education courses and other things. That is your endeavor. Whether to accept or no, that is on them. Okay, so here, for more questions, we are opening that portal. You can log into that and ask more questions. Now I will give opportunity to Samar. So here, Anusha was raising hand. I'll unmute you. You can ask.
Okay, Prabhu. Thank you, Prabhu. Yes,
Anusha, you can unmute now. Thank you, Hare Krishna.
Hello, Guruji. My question is that we'll have to, get rid of a lot of materialistic things, right? So, for example, if we are into a field, like for example, if I am into media field, Guruji, and my media field is such like that, I have to, wear makeup to get on screen for acting, and I have to buy a good camera for YouTube, and I have to need better things for the progress of my work. So if we are if we are using all the materialism for the purpose of the work, is it right or is it considered as a wrong thing?
No, now you also see, I was using virtual screen. I was also trying to put, like yesterday, the screen was a little darker. So it was creating some problem. Today I purchased the light color, but still it was not working properly. I am also using OBS, I am also using YouTube and then touchpad to change between screen and here and there. So when we use these things in the service of Krishna, they are no more material.
Okay, Guru.
But if I am using these things for my self gratification, then it becomes material. Then we get entangled. Now you are using these things for your profession.
Yes, Guru.
So it is not entangling.
Okay.
But if you use these things for self gratification means what? You want to show up yourself or... You want to get unnecessary pride, prestige, position in a society. For that purpose, if you are using, suppose now if I am using this thing so that my YouTube likes should increase. As soon as I put one video in YouTube, 100 and thousands of people should watch. If that is my desire, then that is improper desire.
Okay. Yes.
But if my desire is that if I use all these things, so then those who are the participants, their experience will be better.
Okay.
They can see PPT properly. They can see my video PPT together. Otherwise, it becomes impersonal. If I just show PPT, then you will say, "Arey, from where this Akashvani is happening? Who is speaking? Isn't it?" And if I just show my face and no PPT, nothing, so then you may not get it. "Arey, kuch to bol diya. Nothing is to there."
Yes.
So in this way, if we are using these things for the service of Krishna, and suppose you are in a profession, we are directly using in the service of Krishna.
Yes.
But your profession may not be directly related to Krishna. Then want the people, those are in any profession. Now your profession may be this media, but other people also have different professions. Somebody may be into IT, somebody may be into teaching job and everything. So whatever they earn, they should give some part of their earning to the good cause, and better it should be given to the propagation of Krishna consciousness movement.
Okay.
So if we give that earning, then it is called a purification of our earning.
Okay.
So it will come in Bhagavad Gita in the 15th and 16th chapter. It will come. that how we should purify our different things. Okay. So how to purify money, how to purify our home, how to purify our own existence.
Mm.
That will come in 16, 17 chapter. That will come.
Okay.
Okay. I hope that answers your question.
Yes, Guruji.
Okay. Now here some more hands were up, and in chat also some questions are there. Now I'll take questions from a chat for little time. Here Abhijit is asking a question. Sir, if constitutional and conditional duties are two perpendicular vectors, as you said. No, they are not perpendicular vectors, as you said. Then as a resultant vector, while conducting both duties will be going to 45 degrees. The question is, conditional duty, I told horizontal vector, and constitutional duty is vertical vector. And he's a student of mathematics, so he's telling that the resultant vector will be 45 degrees. So, does that mean conditional duties are also obstructing the constitutional duties as there is a deviation? So, very thoughtful and very amazing question, Abhijit. Thank you very much. Are you there still in the... Abhijit is there. Abhijit Anthari, na? I'll unmute you. Is this your question, Abhijit? Okay, you can unmute.
Hare Krishna Guruji, yes, it is my question.
Okay. So now, sometimes conditional duty becomes obstruction in constitutional duty. That time we have to give preference to constitutional duty. Now I'll tell you some example. You have a choice to go to temple and attend Gita class, or you have a choice to attend a marriage of some of your relative.
Yes.
So attending a marriage is conditional duty.
Yes, sir.
And going to temple and attending a Gita class is constitutional duty.
Yes.
But that time, sometimes you have to choose constitutional duty over your conditional duty. Otherwise, conditional duties become so much that we are not able to focus on the Lord.
Yes.
So that time we have to, so people may say, are sadhu ban gaya, baba ban gaya, you will also become gundu like them.
Yes.
That is not going to happen, don't worry. Everybody will not become gundu. So yes, sometimes we have to compromise on conditional duty or constitutional duty. And for that, we need a maturity. And
yes,
that maturity comes when we put ourselves under the guidance.
Yes.
So that is why after our this course, we are not going to end here. We are going to provide you mentors after our this course so that we can go ahead in our spiritual life nicely. All of you have started your spiritual life. So after this also, we are going to have a mentor system, so that you can go ahead in a life nicely.
Okay. Thank you, Guruji. Thank you.
Hare Krishna. You can mute yourself. So here is the question Shrikari is asking. That what happens to a soul when soul gets a moksha? So, Shrikari, I'll unmute you. You can ask your question properly. You can unmute Shrikari.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji.
Hare Krishna.
It's the same question actually. What happens to the soul if the soul gets moksha?
See, there are two things. One, when soul leaves this body, then either he may go to the spiritual world or he may go to another body in this material world. Now, whether he'll go to spiritual world or no, it depends upon what is his consciousness. Where we go after our death, that depends upon our consciousness. What consciousness I have, what desires I have in my mind. Depending upon that, we go to the next destination. Now I will go to Vaikuntha if I have acquired the qualities of Vaikuntha people. What are the qualities of Vaikuntha people? They are very tolerant, very humble, very submissive. For them, Krishna is the only center. Krishna Eka Sharanam is the quality of a Vaikuntha people. So if one acquires that quality, then he will go to the Vaikuntha and there he will achieve a Siddha Deha. He will not merge into the Brahma Jyoti, but he will acquire a spiritual body and serve the Lord eternally. So he will acquire a spiritual body in the spiritual world and serve there. And if he is not able to get that destination, then in this world only he will acquire some other body depending upon his desires and his karma. Like if somebody performs good karma, he may go to heaven. If somebody is performing bad karma, then he may go to hell. Okay. Is that answers your question, Shrikari? Now, Gauri Manwani, you can ask a question.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji.
Hare Krishna.
Prabhuji, my question is regarding conditional and constitutional duty. While in the earlier discussion it has come where you mentioned that when it is a choice to be made between constitutional and conditional duty, you should choose constitutional duty, that is the duty towards your spirit and serving the God. But while doing that, I understand that, you know, when we do a serving towards God, let's say it is a planned wedding where me and my husband are going, and I tell him that I make a choice of going for a Gita session and you go ahead for the marriage session. So, you know, at that same process, I am creating a disruption with certain relationships that I'm attached with under conditional duty. How do I justify that? Because everybody is not elevated to an extent to understand what is the requirement of constitutional duty, be it two partners living together.
Yes,
so
sure.
How do we justify this to the people that we are living in? We cannot be aloof because we have to live in this world and also, you know, serve the God living in this world itself. How do I strike a balance that this is the level that I have to do my constitutional duty, 2 hours of Krishna chanting and serving the Lord, and then, you know, 22 hours of my conditional duty? Where do I strike this balance and get myself, doing everything at a balanced level? What do I do about it?
Exactly. Very wonderful question, that how to strike a balance. Now, as a wife has to obey the husband. That is a dharma for a wife. And if husband is saying that we have to go for a marriage, then you have to compromise on your Gita class. That is for sure. And then how to strike a balance? Sometimes then gradually we start telling our relatives and even our husband and others our real need. That I have this need of performing this particular amount of sadhana every day. So the how much sadhana we do every day, that I will tell you. Now what is the balance? So every day we give 2 hours for chanting Hare Krishna Maha Mantra and half an hour we give for reading Bhagavad Gita. And then when you are doing some household work, cooking or cleaning, that time you can hear some classes. So this is what somebody can do as a balanced housewife or balanced any person. And apart from that, Sundays we go to temple and take darshan and everything. And then gradually as we progress in our age, our conditional duty should reduce and constitutional duty should increase. Like I can tell you some examples that when people get newly married, then for them the conditional duties increase because they have to settle down in their life. They have to beget children, taking care of them. Now for a mother, when a newly born child is there, she cannot perform all these things. For her, the only chanting 16 round is the compulsory thing. Other things are not required. So balance means it is like a riding a cycle. When we ride a cycle, sometimes when we have to balance the cycle, sometimes we have to go to left, sometimes we have to go to right. So there will be some times in your life where you have to give some more preference to conditional duties, and there will be some times in your life where you have to give more preference to constitutional duty. It depends upon time, place and circumstances. But we never compromise on our chanting daily number of rounds. Whatever chanting you are doing daily, that we continue in any case. Like for example, tomorrow your son's marriage is there. In some period, your son's marriage is there. So now that 1 month will be full busy for you. You cannot read Gita. You cannot go for Gita classes in a temple, isn't it? When we were students, same thing with us. when our exams are there, we cannot hear Gita class, we cannot read Gita class, we cannot read Gita. So what we used to do, just chant 16 rounds, because that vow we have taken. So chant 2 hours, and the remaining 22 hours are for studies. But when in the beginning of college, there are no much studies. So that time we used to go for yatra, nice going to different holy places. So that is how, that time we used to increase our constitutional duties, and conditional duties will be less, studies will be less, and where exams are there, then it will grow. Is that answers your question, Gauri Mataji? Hare Krishna. Okay, Shyamala Mataji want to ask a question. You can unmute yourself, Shyamala Mataji, and ask. Yes.
Radhe Krishna. Sir, you are chanting, and coming back to chanting, you said 2 hours. So we can have 1 hour in the morning, 1 hour in the evening.
Yes, we can have
Number of times to chant.
Actually, it is number of times. See, you know, there is mala, which is consistent of 108 manis or beads. So that we complete 16 times.
16 times.
1-6.
Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare. What is the chant you do?
The mantra is Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Okay. This is a mantra.
So this is 16 times every day. What comes, what goes?
So one round is 108, and that round 16 times. So then it
half an hour of Bhagavad Gita. So just any chapter you take and read, whether you understand.
Mainly, it is recommended that we start Bhagavad Gita from first chapter and go till 18th, because it is systematical progression. That is how we read Bhagavad Gita also.
Okay.
Is that answers your question?
Sir, you said devotional songs, keep it and do the job. So this is a part of our daily life, daily routine.
Yes, surely.
Thank you. Radhe Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Thank you. Ravi Shankar ji, you have a question. You can unmute yourself and ask. Ravi Shankar
ji. Jai Sri Krishna Guruji.
Jai Sri Krishna.
What should be the state of mind when we die, Guruji, to attain moksha?
Our state of mind should be service to Krishna. That I want to serve Krishna and no nothing else and nobody else. When we have this mood of serve Krishna and don't have any independent enjoying mentality, then only we can go back to Krishna. Like now, why we are here? Because we have independent enjoying mentality. We want to enjoy independently from Krishna. Yes. That is why we are here in this world. So when we give up that mentality, then we go back to him.
Yeah. Okay. We should have only the consciousness of Krishna to attain.
Yes, sure.
Namaste, Guruji.
Namaste.
Guruji, I have a doubt. Just say, aapne, sir, can I Hindi?
You can say in English or Hindi, no problem.
Okay. As you said, sir, ki human being or any living being take many janmas. So is there any...
You can ask in Hindi also, no problem.
Take in many janmas. So is there any restriction on the limit of janmas that a living being takes? Or how many janmas does a living being takes?
There is no limit of living beings taking janma. It is not that after 84 lakh species we go to back to garden. No, it is not like that. The time we have this mentality of independent enjoyment, till that time we'll be in this world. So there is no limit for a living entity to take a janma. One after another, living entity keeps on taking different births.
Okay, Guruji. And is there like in this cycle, is there any limitation that living being takes a janma of a human being? Is it so?
Yes. Now we have human form of life. And in human form of life, we have a choice. If we make a good choice and worship the Lord or do punya, if we do punya, we may be elevated to demigods like heavens. And if we worship the Lord and perfect our life, then we'll go to Vaikuntha. There is a difference between Swarga and Vaikuntha. Swarga is not equal to Vaikuntha. Vaikuntha is the place where Lord Vishnu stays, that is beyond this material world. And Swarga is in between this material world only. And once somebody goes to Swarga, when his punya finishes, he will come to this world. And if somebody is doing some sinful activities, then he'll go to lower forms of the species, like dog, cat, or some hellish forms of the species. And after going 8.4 million or 84 lakh species, again he will come to the human form of life. Then again he will be given a choice what to do. And then he may go up or down. Again, same thing.
Okay, Guruji.
Okay, thank you. Shyamananda Prabhuji, you have a question, you can answer the question. Yes. Hare Krishna, Shyamananda Prabhu, are you there? Shyamananda Das, yes. Yes, Prabhuji. Now you are on mute.
Radhe Prabhuji.
Yes.
Can we get an opportunity to attend Srimad Bhagavatam classes?
Yes, surely. Every day we are broadcasting on ISKCON Hyderabad YouTube channel. Every day morning, it is from 8:10 to 9 o'clock. So whatever Bhagavatam classes are happening in a temple, we are broadcasting them every day on YouTube. So, Dr. Dom, what is the name? Dr. He is asking a question that I said in between that we are using these laptops and cell phones in a service of Krishna. So is it a material swadharma? No, it is not a material swadharma. It is like spiritualizing these things. It is not a material swadharma. That is spiritual things. Here, Dr. Manish is asking a question. Dr. Manish, are you there? Very good. Dr. Manish is also not there. Okay, now it is quite late. We'll stop here. KK, are you there? Your one question is there. You are there. So KK is asking a question that Hare Krishna Prabhuji, I prefer to be anonymous. Okay, no problem. Battling in the battlefield is justified. How to battle with the people whose job is to keep on hurting us? How to battle with the people whose job is to keep hurting us? Can answering them back at least after 10 minutes they hurt us justified? Thanks. Will help in dealing daily situations. So yes, actually we can justify our position. That is not a violence. Otherwise, if we just keep on tolerating, it will go beyond our capacity. And then one fine day will burst off. So we can surely justify our position that and keep distance from such people. Those whose job is to hurt us, keep distance from them. Make friendship with somebody else. Okay. So there are many more questions. Sorry, now it is quite late. I will not be able to take all the questions. Okay, here Dhruva Chhabra. Dhruva is there. Dhruva Chhabra is there. He is very eager. His mic is not working. Please answer. If soul is eternal, does anything else remains with the soul? like feelings or any sense or some other kind of energy. In 2.14, what does duality refer to? Third question, can we get this PPT? Would you be, it will be a great reference. Yes, you can get this PPT. That is the answer to your third question. Dhruva, are you there? Then second question, in 2.14, what does duality refer to? Duality means this world is on duality. Like there is a sukha, dukkha, man, apaman, heat, cold. This is called as duality. So this world, if there is a happiness, there has to be sadness. This is like this world. But spiritual world is not like that. There such duality is not there. So we have to tolerate the dualities in this world. Like one of you asked the question that when somebody hurt us, then what to do? We have to tolerate it. That is what we do. And keep distance. And your first question is, if soul is eternal, does anything else remain with the soul? Yes, the relationship which we develop with the Lord and our dealings with the Lord, that remains with the soul. Only that goes with the soul ahead. And when we are in this material world, along with the soul, subtle body also goes. Now I will tell you in short how it is, what happens at the time of death. This is gross body made up of Pancha Mahabhuta, earth, water, fire, air, ether. In that we have subtle body made up of mind, intelligence and ego. And then soul is there. So when we give up this body, then soul goes from one gross body to another gross body with the help of subtle body. So subtle body also grows from one body to another body. That means mind, intelligence and ego goes. And mind is a storehouse of all the desires and thoughts. So till the time we are in this material world, thoughts and desires go from one gross body to another gross body. But when soul gives up this material world and goes back to spiritual world, then subtle body is also given up. Subtle body does not go with the soul that time. Then subtle body is also given up. So now I hope it is quite a lot. Many more questions are there. I will save this chat and we'll try to answer these questions on some Excel sheet or something. We'll answer and send back to you on the WhatsApp groups. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. So here we'll end for the today. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Srimad Bhagavad Gita ki jai. Thank you very much. Till now 45 of you are still there. It is quite late now. Hare Krishna.